Hello everyone, welcome back. So it's tonight, we are hosting our first live session with PTE Leader. In case you don't know me or you haven't met me before, my name is Noshin and I am one of the trainers at PTE Leader and I'm based in Melbourne, Australia. So I really welcome all of you, whoever is watching it from Australia or Vietnam. I'll be really glad to take all of your questions throughout the live session and I'd like to help you out with all of my knowledge and expertise. Feel free to write all of the questions or confusions as we progress further throughout the live session. Right, so let's start our live session for today. Our today's topics are on spelling, fluency, and pronunciation. So I'm going to just quickly start sharing my screen with all of you because that will really help you to understand better what I'm speaking about. Look at something really relevant. So, yep. Alrighty. So today we are going to focus mainly on spelling, fluency, and pronunciation regarding the PTE test. But before we do that, it's really nice to go over the PTE academic basics. So just to refresh your knowledge, whatever knowledge you have already in your mind about the PTE test, let's go over that again before we proceed further. So yes, as we already know, the test lasts for actually 3 hours. So you can finish your test a little earlier than 3 hours as well, but not over 3 hours. So roughly the test takes approximately 3 hours. In this test, all of your skills are tested, all of the 4 skills. So the test actually tests your ability in both of the receptive skills, for example, reading and listening, and also your communicative skills, which are speaking and writing, which are also known as your, communicative skills. So all of these 4 things are being tested in PTE. Then comes another important fact. This test is computer-based. So the AI, artificial intelligence, score your performance in the test. And also this test is integrated. So when you're giving your listening section or you're giving tests for your speaking section, you are not only speaking or listening, you are also to some extent writing and reading different types of texts. So that's why this test is integrated. And also when you do 1 section of this test, you get score for other sections as well. So in both ways, this test is integrated and also the AI scores your performance. This test gives you a score on a scale of 10 and 90. So you can never get less than 10 in this test, no matter how bad is your English, or you can never get higher than 90. So the maximum score you can get in PTE is 90. You can use this test score, this test result, for not only your university entry, but also for your workplace requirements and visa purposes. So if you want to gain more points for your immigration related work, you can use this test result and give to the immigration people and get higher points regarding your visa requirements. So this test overall is very important for not only to show your ability in English, but also increase your chance to live in any English speaking country, for example, in Australia. Right, so now before we talk a little bit more about spelling, fluency, and pronunciation, let's talk about myths and misconceptions, which are always in the air about the PTE test. So where do these come from? There are several reasons these myths actually exist in our society, and we start believing them even though those things are not true. So it's really important to understand that why these myths exist and how do they exist, because when we know that, we can look at why this is happening and we exactly know how to keep ourselves safe from all these sources, from all these sources, and only believe in every credible and valued resources and not whatever myths are going around. So the first important thing, how these myths actually spread, is based on the word of mouth. So for example, I can do something in my test. It can be right, it can be wrong, but without analyzing it, without evaluating it, and without putting it into practice over a period of time, I can spread it to you or maybe to someone else. And then this information will be spread all over the people, all over the world, and people will start believing it without testing it or evaluating it. Now, why this actually happens, why people actually keep spreading information which are not true among other people. The first reason can be faulty thinking. Maybe I did something in my test, and as a result of that, maybe I scored lower than my expectation or higher than my expectation. And then what I'll do is I'll just keep talking about that tip or that trick to my friend or to my students without thinking twice or without putting it into practice more than once, just to ensure myself that if I'm saying the right thing or not. So that can be a faulty thinking. And as a result of that, people can have, biased opinion about this PTE test. Other two reasons regarding these myths and misconceptions can be having misunderstanding of the concepts and believing misinformation about different facts around the test. And again, without judging it further, we keep spreading it. And that may become actually a reason of unnecessary stress for a test taker. Next comes another reason, that is digital world. And I personally believe this is the real catalyst to spread misconceptions throughout the world. Because we all have access to Google, internet, we start seeing different types of posts in Facebook, Instagram, and definitely on YouTube as well. We start to retweet those posts, share those posts virtually and sometimes verbally with our friends and other people. But we don't realize how dangerous it can be if those information are not true, and that can negatively impact people's performance, people's anxiety. They may start, judging their own ability, question their own English proficiency when there was no fault in their English proficiency, but the techniques that they believed they practiced without, analyzing if that is true or not. So yeah, that's another thing which can be very dangerous. Another reason of these myths and misconceptions can be the nature of the test. Now we need to understand this fact. This PTE test is a high stakes test. And all the English proficiency tests are by nature high stakes. So when you give a test which is high stakes, you will have nervousness, you will have stress, and you will have an expectation of doing better than most of the people. So yeah, because of all this pressure that you have on yourself and the expectation that you have to pass the test, maybe in your first go, in your first attempt, you can start believing that you are not good enough, you're not smart enough. And just because you don't, pass the test in one round, you start believing that you are not good enough. So yeah, all these things give you stress. So yeah, in the meantime, I have a question and I think I should take it at the moment. So I have a question from Fan Tang. Do we have break between the PTE test? Thanks for your question, Fan. So yes, you have a 10-minute break in between your PTE test. So the PTE test has three sections, part one, section one, section two, and section three. So after you finish your section two, which is a reading section, so section one is speaking and writing, section two is reading. After you give your section two, you will have a 10-minute break, and then you can start your section three, which is listening. Now this 10-minute break is optional. So you may take it, you may not take it. If you think you need to take a break, you can leave your test room and come back again 10 minutes later. I hope that answers your question. Thanks again for the for asking for a clarification. So as we are as we were talking about that the nature of the test itself can give rise to different types of myths and misconceptions. So we need to be aware of that. Aware of this fact, just because it's a hard thing doesn't mean I can't do it. I need to believe in my ability first before believing in other people. Another thing is very obvious, of course, personal profit. So yes, there are different institutions, different schools, different companies who gives, you know, professional PTE training to students, and they will start talking in a very negative vibe. Like they will start telling you that you are not doing great enough, you are not good enough unless you take classes from my institution, from my company. They will, you know, give you false claims. Like for example, I can ensure you'll get 79 plus in your first attempt, even if you need a lot of improvement in your other English areas, for example, in grammar, in your fluency or in your spelling. There can be lots of things going on which needs to be fixed first before you give your first attempt. But these companies may give you false, you know, claims and expectations about the test. And to advertise themselves, to promote themselves, they will give you kind of misleading information, give rise to myths and misconceptions which are actually not true. So yeah. So we have another question, very interesting question from Julie. I heard that PTE is easier than IELTS. Is it true? Well, Julie, thanks for your question. I personally don't think so. It depends on your expertise in your own language ability, how well you can, you know, use English in your speaking, reading, writing, and listening. Both tests are different in structure and how they are scored. So depending on your personal strengths and areas of improvement, you have to check where you are more comfortable, because when we are comfortable in a test, when we are comfortable in sharing our knowledge, we do better. For some people I have seen, they say PTE is very hard for them. They are more comfortable in IELTS because they have given the test way before than the PTE actually exists in this education industry. And for some people, PTE is easier, absolutely easier than IELTS. So yeah, there is no definite answer. It entirely depends on your English proficiency and in which test you are more comfortable. So yeah, Julie, that's, I hope answers your question. All right, so moving on. So the first topic for tonight is on spelling. So spelling is one of the enabling skills in PTE. So when you give the test and receive your report card, you can see the overall score for all the communicative sections for reading, listening, writing and speaking. And also in your report card, you will have score for individual enabling skills. So spelling is one of the enabling skills, which is mostly underrated. We don't put so much focus into spelling in the PTE test when we take preparation for our PTE test, but this is very important section. So first, what we have to know is, what is spelling? This is really important. So spelling is the pattern of words and set of conventions to write the letters of a word. So how we write a word, how we, you know, pronounce a word, for that spelling is very important, because if you don't write the correct spelling, you may mispronounce a word. And if you write that word in your writing, you will lose mark. So spelling is important. So I have attached a photo here. Always check for spelling errors. And this picture is quite interesting because it has also spellings in almost all of the words. Can any one of you identify what are the mistakes in each of the words? Let's take 1 minute and look at the picture, and let's share in the comment box if you can find what is the wrong spelling or what are the wrong spellings in this sentence. Let's take 1 minute and then I'll proceed further. So in case you are still wondering, this sentence, the word always is wrong because it doesn't have double L, it has only one L. So it would be A-L-W-A-Y-S. The spelling check is also wrong. It would be C-H-E-C-K. Then the word spelling itself is wrong in this sentence. It would be S-P-E-L-L-I-N-G. And the word errors is also wrong. It would be E-R-R-O-R-S. So yes, we always have to check for spelling, especially for PTE. So you may ask, is spelling important in PTE? In short, yes, definitely. Definitely, spelling is really important. So spelling is tested in some item types directly and in some indirectly. So you can get score for right spelling or you can lose score for wrong spellings in some item types. And there are some other item types where spelling is not explicitly tested, but if you have wrong spellings in your answer, you will lose mark. So we're gonna look at those things very shortly. So why spelling is important? Spelling is not only important for listening or writing section, spelling is also important for reading section, because this is important to pronounce words correctly. When you have an item type of read aloud, if you don't know the correct spelling of a word, you will fail to pronounce it correctly, and that way you will lose mark in pronunciation, and also you will lose mark in content for different types of speaking item types. Spelling is also important to increase your English vocab repertoire. So the better spelling you know about a word, the more your collection of words will be. And the more you will understand when you read different types of texts in English. So it's very important. Spelling is very important to improve your overall vocabulary. So where is spelling assessed? So you can ask me where spelling is directly tested, evaluated in your PTE test. So before we proceed, I have a question again from, sorry, I can't pronounce this name. I am imagining it would be Gwen. So the question is, do I lose marks if I made only one spelling mistake? Well, it actually depends what type of question you are writing at the moment. For example, if you're doing essay, you have 2 points for essay in for spelling. If you make one spelling mistake, you will lose 1 point. So out of two, you will get one. If you make more than one spelling mistake, you will get, unfortunately, zero. So it really depends what type of item type you are doing and how many points are allotted for that kind of item type. We will talk about that in a bit, so stay tuned for more information about spelling. All right, so as we were talking where spelling is assessed, this spelling will directly be assessed in two item types in your whole PTE test. The first item type is essay. So per question, so per essay, you will have 2 points. So in your test, if you have one essay in writing section, you will have 2 points for spelling. If you have two essays in your test, you will have 4 points in total. Now in your test for writing section, you will never get more than two essays. So the maximum point for spelling is 4 from the writing section. For each essay again, you will have 2 points. For no spelling mistakes. If you make one mistake, you will have 1 point only. If you make more than one mistake, you will get 0 points. So yeah. No worries, Nguyen. I hope that answers your question. If not, feel free to ask me more questions in the comment box. I'll be happy to answer. All right, after essay, we have summarized spoken text from listening section where our spelling is tested again. For this one, for summarized spoken text, again, we have 2 points per question. If you have one summarized spoken text, you have 2 points. If you have two summarized spoken text questions, you have 4 points in total. And if you have three summarized spoken text questions, you will have 6 points in total. Now, in your main PTE test, official main PTE test, you can get maximum 3 summarized spoken text questions or minimum 2 summarized spoken text questions, never 1. So either you will have 4 total points in spelling or 6 total points in spelling, depending on how many questions you get. So these are the two item types, essay and summarized spoken text, where you have explicitly score for spelling section. Right, so there are other two question types where your spelling is indirectly assessed. The first one is fill in the blanks in listening section, and another one is write from dictation in the listening section. Now for these two question types, spelling is not separately assessed, but just let's imagine in fill in the blanks, you have to type type a word in specific blank. Now if you make spelling mistake, it just means you haven't written the exact word that you were supposed to write, so you will lose point. The same is true for write from dictation as well. If you were supposed to write one sentence and you make mistake in one word, you make spelling error in one word, definitely it means that you have not written the exact word that you were supposed to write, so you will lose point again. So in this case, your overall score in listening sections will be reduced. So the less spelling mistakes you make, the more you get score for both fill in the blanks and write from dictation. And as a result, your overall listening score will be higher. So I feel like personally, where your spelling is indirectly assessed in fill in the blanks and write from dictation, compared to the essay and summarized spoken text questions, these two sections are more dangerous because your overall performance will be lowered if you are not well or if you are not proficient in spelling different types of words in English. So where should you focus more? Do I need to focus more on directly assessed questions like essay and summarized spoken text, or indirectly assessed question, for example, fill in the blanks and write from dictation? The short answer is both. Obviously, you need to focus a lot in your spelling for essay writing and also summarized spoken text. But at the same time, we have to focus on our spelling for fill in the blanks and write from dictation questions. Because if the word spelling is wrong, it means the computer will assume you haven't written that word and you will lose point for overall listening score. So yes, you need to focus on your spelling for both of the types of questions, directly assessed and both indirectly assessed question types. So yes, however, the questions where spelling is indirectly assessed are more important because these item types directly influence your overall PTE academic score. So keep this thing in your mind. Myth around spelling. Now, obviously, there is a myth around the spelling, and I'm not sure if you have heard about this or not, but in case you have, we are gonna bust that thing together. So the myth is using the backspace button reduces your score. Now, I have seen a lot of students come to me asking if I'm allowed to use the backspace button when I'm typing my answer for essay, write from dictation, or fill in the blanks. The short answer is yes, definitely you can use the backspace button and it is never going to reduce your score for spelling. So this is absolutely a wrong concept. You can use backspace as many times as you want. I personally, when I gave my test, I have used a lot of times this backspace button while I typed my answer for essay, summarized spoken text, write from dictation sentences, and also for filling the blank words. I use backspace a lot, but still I managed to score a 90 out of 90 in listening and writing sections. So obviously this is a wrong concept because I personally have tested this one and this proved to be wrong one. So this is absolutely a myth. Feel free to fix your spelling using backspace button if you think your spelling is wrong. Also, if you go to the Pearson website, you will be able to see Pearson never said in any of the official score guidelines that uses of backspace will result in less marks. So keep this thing in your mind that if you can't find any information in the official Pearson site, that is a myth or that is a wrong concept. That is not a right thing. Because if it is true, it will be mentioned on the Pearson website. So your go-to guideline, your go-to, you know, mentor will be your Pearson website and all the official documents that they have uploaded on the website. So you should know that backspace have no effect on your PTE academic score. Yes. However, this one thing that avoiding backspaces can give you more chance to reread your response, resulting in more accurate spellings. So obviously, if someone comes to you and tells you that, yes, I never used backspace button in my test and I scored higher, then yeah, it can be a coincidence, because if you think it this way, when you know that you are not allowed to use backspace, you will be more conscious about writing your spellings, about writing your words. You will have more chance to reread your response. You will have more chance to reread your words for your essay or summarized spoken text, because you know in your mind that I am not allowed to use backspace. So I'll be more cautious about what I write and how I write it. So yes, in a way, that will boost your score, but it's not because you didn't use backspace, but it's because you are more cautious, you are more conscious about what you write and how you write it. So yeah, there is no link between not using backspace and having a dramatic boost in your overall score in PTE. So yes, feel free to use backspace as many times as you want. So I have a question from Julie. How can you improve your spelling? That's a very interesting and useful question, Julie. Please stay with me, bear with me for a while, because I'm gonna talk about that in a bit. So yeah, how to improve spelling. I feel like, Julie, your timing is very perfect. The moment you ask me, I'm gonna also talk about the exact same thing. But before we talk about how to improve our spelling, I just want to emphasize more on one quote by Evelyn Waugh. He is a very famous author, and in one of his writings, he talked about this quote: "One forgets words as one forgets names. One's vocabulary needs constant fertilizing or it will die." So here the word fertilizing is actually being used as an analogy. It actually means that we always need to be in practice to improve our overall spelling. If you want to remember and, you know, use as many English words as you can, all the time, every single day, you have to be in practice of writing, listening, you know, speaking of different words. If you don't practice, you will forget spelling of very common English words. So yes, Julie, if you really want to improve your spelling, my personal suggestion would be, first, learn the spelling of most frequently used words. If you go to Google and search for most frequently used words in English, or if you want to be more precise, you can search for like most frequently words used in PTE or in writing or English academic context, you will find heaps of resources. You will find lots of words which are most frequently used all the time in different academic topics. Download those resources and start practicing every single day. This is the shortest but most effective way of improving your overall spelling, you know, skill. Another way of doing it is having a practice, a regular practice of content-related vocab on a regular basis. So, for example, you can take a topic of education. This is a content. And then you can search for different words related to the topic education. You can also take sports. You can take health. You can take society, politics, so many contents over there. And after you search for it on Google, you can download all the relevant vocab and start practicing. This will not only help you to improve your spelling overall, but will help you to write better for your essay in your writing section. you will not struggle anymore about, you know, writing what you should write and what not to write. And also it will help you to improve your fill in the blanks and write from dictation questions, because most of the content for write from dictation, fill in the blanks would be related to education, would be related to common societal issues. So if you have more knowledge about those issues, those content, that will also help you write good answers for fill in the blanks and write from dictation as well. So this is overall a very win-win situation for all of us. A short tip to incorporate your spelling practice every single day is to use one word throughout the day. And that way you will remember it more. Your brain will retain that word for a longer period of time. Take a word every single morning and try to use it sometimes before you go bed at the same day. So in the morning, maybe I take a one word, for example, the word vocabulary. Let's imagine the word vocabulary is very new for me. So I wake up in the morning, choose this word for the day, for the whole day, and I'll keep using this word whenever I have free time, whenever I have a chance, I have an opportunity, I'll practice this thing before I go bed at night. This way, you not only know, you know, where to use this word, but also you will remember this word for a longer period of time because you have practiced it more than enough amount of times. So yeah, this is one way of improving your spelling, not only for PTE, but also for your overall English uses in your everyday life. Another way of improving your spelling is check your spelling from bottom to top or right to left. So if you write an essay in your writing section, or if you write a summary for summarized spoken text, usually when we revise our own writing, we start from the top and also from the left side, because we start writing from the left side. And then we start from the top when we start writing. And so after you finish your writing, if you start revising in the same manner, most of the times you will not acknowledge your mistakes. Because when you do check your writing from the top and from the left side, you just notice the first beginning letter and the end letter. Most of the times we don't focus on the middle letters, and that's why we make mistakes when we have wrong spelling of a word. So if you want to, if you are a kind of person who doesn't have problem with writing the spelling but make a lot of typing errors, maybe you try this strategy. You start revising from conclusion and then you go back to the introduction, and also check from right to left side instead of left to right side. That way you will understand and identify more mistakes if you have any. So yes, for essay, check spelling from conclusion towards introduction. So first you will revise conclusion, then body paragraph 2, body paragraph 1, and then introduction. Yes, so checking spellings backward will force your brain to focus on the spelling patterns, or also sometimes each letter of one word. And that way you will be able to identify more mistakes in your writing and fix it before it's too late. Right, so no worries, Julie. I'm really glad to be able to help you out with your spelling struggle. I hope you will try this strategy next time and see if it really improves your overall spelling score or not. All right. Now it's time for fluency and pronunciation. Feel free to ask me about spelling questions if you have any. I'll be happy to help you out. In the meantime, let's progress further with fluency and pronunciation. Now, what is fluency and what is pronunciation? This is very important to understand before we build our own strategies, tips, and tricks to improve it. So what is fluency? Fluency means our ability to speak or write a foreign language easily and accurately. So when we say that someone is very fluent, it means they can speak that specific language. It doesn't have to be English only. It can be Vietnamese language. It can be something else. whatever language you are using, whatever language you're speaking, it has to be very, very natural when you speak, in that you are not giving so many unnatural pauses, you are not hesitating, you are not mumbling while you're speaking. You are very natural, very accurate, very precise, and you can explain what you want to explain to other person effortlessly. That's when we can say that that person is fluent, that person has a very good fluency when they use the specific language. So that's fluency. What is pronunciation? Pronunciation means the way in which a word or a language is spoken. So how you say a word, how you use a language, if you can utter all the words, all the syllables, all the sounds accurately or not, that depends on your pronunciation. Now, these two things together are definitely very important for speaking section in PTE. So fluency and pronunciation are evaluated in speaking item types in read aloud. So read aloud is the first question, the first item type in your speaking section, and also for the oral PTE test as well. So when you start your test, when you start, giving the test, the first question type that you will encounter is read aloud. Here, they will give you a passage and then you have to read aloud exactly in the same way that passage has been written. And obviously, your fluency and pronunciation are very important for this item type. After read aloud, you will have repeat sentence in the speaking section. And again, here, fluency and pronunciation are tested. Then we have describing image, and then we have written lecture. So in describe image, they will give you a picture or an image, and then you have to start speaking about that image. You have to describe that image. So for example, here in my slide, you can see a girl, a very beautiful girl, in blue dress and blue hair. So in your PTE test, you can have an image like this, and then you will have some amount of time where you have to start speaking and describe the image as you see. So obviously here as well, you will have your scores, a designated score for fluency and pronunciation. Written lecture, again in speaking section, where they will play an audio about any topic for a while. You listen to it, and after listening to it, you have to retell the whole lecture, what you understood from the lecture in your own language. So you have to speak a lot, and obviously the computer's AI system is going to check your fluency and pronunciation for all of these question types. So yes, we have to be naturally very fluent, and we need to have a very clear pronunciation of all the words we speak and how we deliver it over our microphone. So yes. Now, myths around fluency and pronunciation. There are lots of very interesting myths that I hear, and sometimes I laugh, like, I don't know where people get all of these things. So myth number two, is you need to speak louder to get a higher score in PTE. Now, I'm not sure if you have heard about this myth before. If not, you are lucky, because now you have the myth buster with you that yes, this is absolutely not true. It's a very wrong concept. You don't necessarily have to be louder to get a higher score in your PTE speaking. And if you think it this way, when you're giving the test in a test room with other people in the same room, it is kind of disrespectful for other test takers as well. So what happens is when you go to give the test in any one of the PTE centers, in one room there will be other people with you giving the same test in the same room. Mostly it can be during this COVID situation, maximum 5 or 6 people. Before COVID situation, there was time when people used to give like 10, 12 people in one room. But now you are lucky because you have less people. However, just imagine you are giving your speaking section test, you are doing the read aloud or repeat sentence, and someone else is yelling and screaming over the microphone right beside you. It's going to be very annoying for you, and you will have a hard time to focus in whatever you are doing. So the same can happen to someone else if you scream, if you yell in your microphone, because simply you don't need to scream all the time. So yes, we have to be very cautious about how our actions can influence negatively to other people who are also giving the test as you are giving. So in PTE, the headphone they give you and the microphone, the headset actually, together with headphone and microphone they give you, is basically equipped with noise cancellation software. So when you speak in your microphone and after that the AI gives you score for your speaking section, it has actually the ability to isolate or extract your voice from the background noise. So the system can understand which one is your voice and which one is someone else's voice in the background. So you don't have to worry a lot about it because the computer will take care of it. So just focus on speaking naturally, speaking accurately as it is and as you should be speaking, instead of worrying too much about what if the other person's voice come into my microphone, or what if my voice, the computer doesn't understand that it's my voice, and all those unnecessary stuff. You don't have to worry a lot about that. So I have a question from Noo. Are fluency and pronunciation marked separately or together in PTE? Thanks for your question, Noo. Yes, in your speaking section, the fluency and pronunciation both have separate marking. So you get maximum 5 points for fluency, you can get maximum 5 points for pronunciation. They are assessed separately, not together. But when you prepare for both fluency and pronunciation, you have to improve your speaking, and both fluency and pronunciation actually come together. So that's why the myths are around both fluency and pronunciation together. But when the computer gives you the test score, it is very separate. Right. So this is important about being louder. You don't have to be louder. So speaking, you have to speak at a standard volume. I'm not saying at your natural volume, because some people are really soft spoken, very soft. Their voice is very soft. So when they speak in their natural tone, that voice is not appropriate for the microphone, is not strong enough for the microphone, you know, to, you know, understand whatever you're saying and to give you a score. So for those people whose voice is very soft, who are soft spoken, they have to do a little bit work. They have to exert to practice to speak at a standard volume, to be a little louder than they usually do. But that doesn't mean you will start speaking in a very loud voice and literally, which can be leveled as screaming. Definitely you're not going to do that. But if you're very silent, very, very soft, in that case you have to give your voice a little bit force to sound natural, as a very standard voice. So yeah, you don't have to be louder, you just have to be yourself. If you are soft, in that case just force yourself a little bit, otherwise you should be fine. Third myth is accents help you score better. So sometimes people have this firm belief that if I don't sound like typical Australian or typical American or British people, I'll not have a good score, which unfortunately again is a very wrong concept. You can never have an accent which make you sound like a native speaker, but definitely you can still score very good point, 90 out of 90 in your speaking section, depending on how fluent you are and how accurately you pronounce different words in speaking section. So the test, the PTE people know that the people who do not speak English as their first language are going to give the test. So definitely, if you sound like native person, you are usually not going to give the test. If you're not native person, you are going to give the test. So obviously, PTE will test you, will assess your ability when you are a non-native speaker. So that makes sense. If you sound like a native speaker, it means you are a native speaker and you don't need to give this test. You're giving the test because you're not an English speaker. English is not your first language. So obviously the computer will understand, even if you don't have an accent, which will make you sound like a native speaker. So the PTE's AI, the artificial intelligence system, is trained with accents of people from all over the world who use English as a second language. So that's why you don't worry a lot about it. the only thing you have to focus is that if you're pronouncing all the words accurately or not. That's the only thing you should be worrying about if you want to worry at all. Be mindful to pronounce words clearly and naturally. So yes, that's the only thing you have to worry about, that it doesn't matter what type of accent I have. All I have to focus on is when I'm pronouncing each word in my read aloud, I'm pronouncing it properly, clearly, and completely. There is no hesitation in my voice. There is no mumbling in my voice. Lastly, if you're confused about the difference between accents and pronunciations, you can spend some time understanding this difference. So if you are worrying, what is the difference between having an accent? What is the difference between accent and pronunciation? You can spend some time into understanding the difference. But just for your help, I want to give you a very basic difference between these two. Accent is your voice, the way you stress different parts of a word. You use rhythm, you use intonation when you're speaking a language. That is accent. And pronunciation means how well you can exactly pronounce a word, how well you can, you know, utter a word using whatever accent you have. So these two things are definitely very different from each other. You can have your own mother language's accent. For example, if you are from Vietnam, you can have Vietnamese accent, but at the same time, you can pronounce a word exactly as it is. So yes, feel free to spend some time into understanding the difference if that helps you to prepare better. All right, then comes myth four. Speaking faster increases your score. Now, there are a lot of people who think if I have a passage in front of me, I have 40 seconds to finish this passage. The faster I can finish, the louder I can finish, it will increase, it will secure me better score in PTE speaking section. Again, this is not true. If you speak faster, that will not definitely automatically give you a boost in your speaking section. This is a very wrong concept. Remember that your fluency score depends on your ability to speak without unnatural gaps. So when you are speaking, for example, you have two sentences that you have to read aloud. Now for the first sentence, you are very fast, very easily you could finish. And in the second sentence, you got a word, you have no idea how to pronounce that word. Or the second sentence is very complicated. Let's take it for example. So what will happen? The first sentence was easy, so you could read it very fast. And when you come to the second sentence, you will be very slow. You will have unnatural gaps, and that will hinder your ability to speak fluently. So if you look at the picture in this slide, there are three pictures, 1, 2, and 3. Picture 1 and picture 2, if you see the wavelength, it's very erratic. Sometimes it's up, sometimes it's down. If your fluency is something like that, sometimes you are faster, sometimes you are slower, the computer will think you are not fluent enough. You are not good enough when you start speaking. And that way you will actually get lower score in fluency for all of the speaking questions. So from Julie, I have a question. Do you have any tips on practicing for pronunciation? Thanks, Julie. This is a very good question, and I don't have a very specific answer to this, unfortunately, because lots of people have lots of different kinds of problems regarding pronunciation. Some people actually have struggled to pronounce a word, the beginning of the word. Some people have problem in pronouncing a word, and they don't focus much on the ending of a word. Right? Different people have different problems, but a short suggestion can be that you go to Google, and when you have struggled about the pronunciation of a specific word, search the word in Google and they will automatically suggest to you the pronunciation. So when you look for a meaning, they also have a short logo beside the word of mic. So if you click on that logo, you can instantly listen how this word is pronounced. to be even better, you can choose if you want to listen to the American accent or the British accent, I mean the pronunciation of the word. So if you practice American pronunciation, you can choose that and click that mic option, and you can listen to the pronunciation, how American people pronounce that word. In the same way, if you follow British people or Australian accent, you can also click the British option, British pronunciation, and listen to the word's pronunciation, how British people pronounce that word. You can also sometimes use text-to-speech apps where you write a sentence and the computer will pronounce the sentence exactly as it is. So you can listen to it and have an idea how native people actually say these words or this sentence in which way. Apart from this, if you already know the pronunciation of a word but you still have struggled to improve yourself, what I suggest is keep listening to those words every single day. And if you have hesitation in your mouth when you're pronouncing because your mother language is, you know, causing problem, giving hindrance in pronouncing that word in English, keep you know, uttering that word every single day. That way, gradually, you will have less hesitation in your mouth and you will sound more and more like native speakers and how they pronounce the word exactly as it is. So coming to a nutshell point, it's come to one point, one suggestion, that is practicing every single day. First, you have to figure out what is the correct pronunciation, because only practice can never improve you. If you don't have any idea what is the correct pronunciation of a word, you will keep practicing the wrong pronunciation. So first, we have to figure out what is the right pronunciation of a word. You can use Google or you can ask your native speaker friend if you have any. And after you figure out the correct pronunciation, then keep practicing. Keep practicing and keep using that word or those phrases every single day in your communication. I think that will really help you if you become consistent in what you do. I hope that answers your question, Julie. Right, so whatever we were talking about, speaking faster or slower, that was our topic. So yes, as I was saying, if you sometimes are very fast and sometimes very slow, that will change the way the computer perceives your presentation, perceives your pronunciation of specific word and your fluency for specific sentence. That way, actually, you will get less score, lower score in fluency and pronunciation. So if you look at the picture 3 from the slide, that wavelength is kind of like stable. So if when you speak, is consistent, not too fast, not too slow, your wavelength would be similar to picture 3. And that's what actually our goal is. Because when you speak in microphone and the computer takes it as an input, in the computer system, all of our responses for speaking section goes into this way as a form of wavelength. So the computer actually checks wavelength, not exactly your voice. So the more stable the wavelength is, the better your fluency and pronunciation score will be. The more erratic it is, as picture one and two are showing, the harder for you it will be to improve your score in fluency and pronunciation. So when you pause for a little longer than usual, your fluency score dramatically goes down. So for example, as I was giving the example, if you have two sentences or three sentences, two sentences are very easy for you. So you are very fast, very smooth. And the third sentence is very hard for you. So you pause. And when you pause for a little longer than usual time, computer will think, well, this person is a gone case. This person cannot be very fluent. Sometimes this person is very smooth. Sometimes this person is not very smooth. Their fluency is not trustable. The computer will give you very low score in fluency. So the suggestion would be you can speak as naturally as you do and still get the desired score if you do it consistently. The most important thing to remember is to speak consistently. So the word consistent, you should focus on the word consistent and not faster. When you speak for read aloud, when you speak for describe image, when you speak for written lecture, keep in mind that you have to be consistent. Whatever fluency pace you have, It can be very fast, it can be very slow, it can be medium. Whatever space you have as your natural form, keep that consistent throughout your speaking section. Now, obviously, if you start talking like a tortoise, that would be a problem. We don't speak like a tortoise in that space, obviously. We are a little bit faster than a tortoise, like duh. Whatever your natural pace is, keep that, and keep that as a consistent form of speaking. Don't be like faster sometimes, slower sometimes, because that will cause a problem. You are most welcome, Julia. I am very glad to be able to help you out. If you have more questions, you can just pop that up in the comment box and I'll be answering that if I have that knowledge. So before we talk about key takeaway points, I just want to give a good demonstration of a read aloud example, how your fluency and pronunciation should be when you do a read aloud question. So I'm gonna share my screen and take you right away to our PTE Leader platform. So if you enroll with us, you will have access to our PTE Leader platform, and you will find heaps of practice questions for all the four sections that are assessed in PTE. We have questions for speaking, we have questions for writing, listening, and reading as well. And you can practice as many times as you want each question until you are happy with your performance or unless your trainer is very happy with you. So I believe you can see the web page from our PTE Leader platform. This is a read aloud question actually from our website. So in your test, they will give you a passage like this. This is actually not passage. This is like literally two sentences. Sometimes you can get short passages like this. Sometimes you can get a passage with 5, 6, or 7 sentences as well. It depends on PTE, what type of passages they will give you. So before I give you a demonstration, let me take another question from the comment. Can we bring water into PTE test? Unfortunately, no. You can't bring your own water bottle. So if you are thirsty or if you want to drink water before you start your test, they will have water resource in the test center. So before you go to the test room, they will do all the formalities like check your ID, take your picture and all those things. You will be sitting in a waiting room, and in that room, you will have water flux, water jug and all of those things. You will have washroom as well. So you can drink from there. And during the test, you will not even have time to feel you are thirsty, trust me. So during the test, you will feel like you just started and you will finish 3 hours in a blink of eye. So there is no point of thinking that if I'll be thirsty during my test, you will not be. You will be too stressed to worry about being thirsty. But in case you do, you will have you can have water from their jug or from their water bottle. You can't bring your own water bottle during the test in the test room. So yeah, feel free to drink water as much as you want before you start your test. So yeah, read aloud. So let's just have a look into the sentences. So before you start your read aloud question, answering a read aloud question, you will have 40 seconds to prepare. And then what will happen, you will read it aloud in your natural voice without being louder, without screaming at the microphone, without being faster, and also without faking your accent. So you will be as natural as possible. So let me read it out for you so you have a better understanding of what you should be doing. The evidence for the harmful effects of alcohol on brain health is compelling, but now experts have pinpointed 3 key time periods in life when the effects of alcohol are likely to be at their greatest. So if you're listening to me, you know, I'm not very fast when I'm speaking. I'm not very slow either. I have exactly kept the same pace when I read this passage out. So you should be doing the same thing as well. So a very wrong example, what you should not be doing is this. The evidence for the harmful effects of alcohol on brain health is compelling, but now experts have pinpointed three key time periods in life when the effects of alcohol are likely to be at their greatest. This is absolutely a wrong example of doing the read aloud. This is way faster than the computer can actually track. You should not be doing this. So this is a wrong example. Another kind of wrong example of read aloud can be being too slow. So that is the evidence for the harmful effects of alcohol on brain health is compelling. But now, experts have pinpointed three key time periods in life when the effects of alcohol are likely to be at their greatest. So this is absolutely another no. This is way too slow, and also there were some unnatural pauses in middle when I did not understand a word, for example, if that's you. So that's too slow. And another example I just showed, that was too fast. We should be avoiding both and be as natural as possible. All right, so let's go back to our slides for tonight. We are actually almost at the end of our today's session. So before we finish and wrap it up, I want to go through all the key takeaway points from today's live session. The first thing that we have learned from all the myths and busting those myths is that you can absolutely use backspace key in your test as many times as you want and as much as you want. Practice word spellings regularly to improve your communicative and enabling skills. So yes, we have to practice our spelling for essay, for summarized spoken text, for fill in the blank, and for write from dictation. Check spelling backward from bottom to top, especially for for summarized spoken text and essay, where actually you are writing at length, you are writing passages. In those scenarios, if you check your spelling backward from bottom to top, from right to left, that would be really helpful. You can speak using your natural tone. As I said, you don't have to scream, you don't have to be louder. You can keep your natural tone. Focus on the correct pronunciation of words. So obviously, if you want to get maximum point for read aloud, for describing image, for retelling lectures, you have to pronounce the words exactly as it is, because otherwise computer will assume you don't know the word and will not give you point for content. So knowing the correct pronunciation is really important. Speak at a standard volume. As I said, you have to be very natural. You have to have a very standard volume, not very harsh, not very soft. You have to be in the middle ground. Next one, speak consistently. As I said, if you become sometimes very fast, sometimes very slow, it's gonna create a very, very much mess, and you will lose so much score in fluency and pronunciation. Instead of that, we have to be very consistent when we speak. We have to keep our natural pace, we have to keep our natural volume, and we have to keep our natural accent. That's the best way you can improve your fluency and pronunciation score, and also spelling score. So yeah, that's pretty much it is for tonight's session. Now, if you have any question, please write that up in the comment box. I'll be happy to take it and answer if I can. So I have another question from Julie. This is really useful. Thank you, Julie, for liking this session and finding all the information very useful. So the question is, when is the next workshop? So hopefully we will again meet on next week. Please keep your eyes open and, you know, look for more information for next week's live session and topic. Now, for your own betterment, if you feel like there is a specific topic you want to learn more about, you can mention those topics in the Facebook comment box as well. we will take those topics and do the live stream session in the next week if we can. So if you feel like there is specific concept of PTE or specific strategy that you are worried about, you don't have much idea about, and you want to learn more about it, feel free to give us suggestions and opinions. We are very happy to take it. So yes, that's it. And for the next workshop, that will be hopefully next Thursday again in the same time, but still make sure you have an eye open for further information from PTE Leader. All right. From Gwen, thanks Noshin, this is amazing. I'm very, very glad and very, very happy that I could be very useful tonight and help you out. One very basic and you know, one very effective suggestion is, which all of the people know, but still I want to repeat myself, that is don't stress, because the more you will stress, the worse it will be. So be proud that you are making it slowly but effectively. At least you are not having any misconception as you are progressing and improving your English skill. And also, you will be there. You will get your score if you're just patient, consistent, dedicated, and enthusiastic in your English improvement. Another comment from Fan Tang. I need to learn more about vocab and listening tips. Yes, Fan, we will plan our next live stream session something around listening as well. For vocabulary, as I say tonight, regarding my spelling suggestion for vocabulary improvement, just go to Google and look for most frequently used words in English. And also search for content-related vocabulary that will really help you for writing essay, for understanding words in Write From Dictation and summarize spoken text, all right? Otherwise, for listening tips and all other different myths we have around listening section, I'll try to bring those things in limelight in our next workshop, in our next live stream session. And I hope you'll be there in next week and learn more about it. No problem. So I'll be waiting a couple of minutes more for more questions. I have a question from Jin Cook. Well, I have never taken the PTE test. As far as I know, PTE will be much easier than IELTS about speaking, but are reading, listening, and writing of PTE easier than IELTS? So Jin, thank you for your question and the concern as well. As I answered this question in the very beginning of our today's session, it actually depends. Jean, if you feel like your speaking is very good, irrespective of the fact you give IELTS or PTE, you will do good. But if you feel like, no, my reading skill is not very good, I'm not very confident in reading, listening, and writing, that would be the case in PTE as well. So it really depends. And for PTE specifically, it's not only about your English ability, English knowledge, but also about how well you can incorporate different types of strategies that are useful for the test. So it's a mixture, 50-50 mixture of English skill and ability, and 50% of your own strategies and how well you can incorporate those strategies within the given time frame for different types of item types. Another question from Jim Cook, how long could I practice PTE before I can take the test? Again, it depends on English proficiency. If you feel like your English is perfect, all right. In that case, I would say 1 and 1.5 months should be good enough if you practice every single day. But if you feel like that my English is not very good, I'm not very fluent, or I don't have enough knowledge about the grammar concept of English, first allocate some time to fix those areas, fill those gaps. And then we will start taking, you know, time for improving our PTE, different PTE item types. So it depends. If you have more things to fill up in your English knowledge, it will be more than two months. I would say 3-4 months to overall improve yourself. But if you feel like, no, I'm very confident in my English, I don't need to work so much in grammar, pronunciation, fluency, 1 or 2 months should be enough. So it really depends from person to person. There is no specific timeline I can give to any student. Right, I hope, Jean, that answers your question. So yeah, I'll be waiting for some time more to answer more questions if you have any. And also you can suggest more topics for future live stream sessions as well, if you want to learn more about different other aspects of PTE test. In the meantime, I just want to go through this stuff as well. If you feel like you need to take sessions with us in at PTE Leader, feel free to reach out to us using our Facebook page, email, Instagram, or website. We are always there 24/7 to help you out with all of your confusions and concerns. So yeah, anytime you can reach out to us and we'll be happy to help you out. You're most welcome, Jean. I hope that helps you with your PTE journey. Yep, alrighty. So yes, so if you don't have any further question, I would like to stop the live stream session tonight right here. Good night to everyone, and thank you so much for joining us tonight here, and I hope it was effective and very fruitful for all of you. I'll see you next week again. Till then, stay safe and stay healthy. Good night.